Okay.
All right. Good morning or afternoon, depending on where you are. And thank you for joining Pituitary Network Association's webinar program. Our webinar program is brought to you through the support of our sponsors and our expert contributors. The PNA is dedicated to educating people with pituitary disorders, their families, and their healthcare providers. The PNA is a nonprofit organization that relies on the support from our members and donors. During the webinar, please feel free to type in your questions at any time. Take note that all questions will be saved until the end of the webinar. We have allotted time to answer as many questions as possible. Any questions that are not answered will be reserved and answered by email. Today's webinar, Endoscopic Endonasal Surgery for the Treatment of Cushing's Disease, is being presented by Dr. Mary Kudurushu. Dr. Kudurushu is an attending neurosurgeon and assistant professor at the University of Louisville. She is the director of the Pituitary and Skull Base Program. Dr. Kudurushu received her MD from the Aristotle University in Thessalonica, Greece, and completed her neurosurgical residency at the General Hospital of Athens in Greece. She underwent subspecialty fellowship training in endoscopic pituitary surgery and minimally invasive neurosurgery at the UMC Sanrabod Nijmegen in the Netherlands. She moved to the United States in 2010 and completed 4 years of research and a clinical fellowship in endoscopic and open skull base surgery at the UPMC Presbyterian in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Dr. Kudurushu has published extensively in the field of endoscopic skull base surgery. Her studies have been presented in national and international neurosurgical meetings. Dr. Kudurushu's work in skull base surgery has been recognized by the European Skull Base Society and the World Federation of Skull Base Societies. I apologize for mispronouncing any of those words. Thank you for your involvement in our webinar program. There will be a brief delay as we change presenters, and now on your side you should see a request for you to accept.
Hello.
Hi. Did you get the request to accept? Ah, I see your screen. So.
Okay. So I guess you can hear me.
I can hear you. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Very much for the invitation. I'm wondering why I cannot go to maybe.
Should be
okay, here we are.
There you go.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm really excited to be today with you and present my experience and some update of this fascinating disorder, the Cushing's disease, which is a huge clinical challenge both for the diagnosis and the treatment. Although my talk is focused on the endoscopic endonasal treatment, which is my field of expertise, I would like to give an overview on the disease, talking about clinical symptoms, the pathophysiology of the disease, the diagnostic tools that are available nowadays, and of course, focus on this new and revolutionary approach through the nose with the endoscope that allow us for a gross total resection of the tumor even when the tumor is invading the lateral margins, the cavernous sinus, and it is a very difficult case to remove. So I will suggest we should start then. Of course, Cushing's disease is the condition, the definition of the disease is the condition of hypercortisolemia. It's a condition when the adrenal glands are producing very high levels of cortisol in response to increase secretion of the ACTH, an adrenocorticotrophic hormone, by the pituitary tumor, a pituitary adenoma. Cushing's disease is a rare disorder, however, it's a really interesting condition which has a very bad impact on patients' quality of life. It's very difficult to be diagnosed. Sometimes even the clinical presentation are overlapping features, clinical features that can represent more common today's conditions like obesity or diabetes or depression. So the big challenge is the diagnosis before going to the treatment. Hypercortisolemia is the definition of Cushing syndrome, and under this umbrella we have different pathologies. Cushing disease is just one of the causes of Cushing syndrome. Cushing disease is because of the presence of a pituitary adenoma, and this is present in 7% of the conditions of Cushing syndrome. A big percentage can be an adrenal tumor that producing independently high levels of cortisol, or another potential cause can be paraneoplasmatic syndromes, usually a small cell lung cancer, and all of these etiologies can result in hypercortisolemia. So the challenge is to find which exactly is the cause, to have a final diagnosis before proceeding to the treatment. Cushing syndrome describes the signs and symptoms associated with prolonged exposure to inappropriately high levels of cortisol. And if it's left untreated, it is associated with very high morbidity and mortality, mainly because of the vascular disease associated with hypertension, the diabetes that these people are suffering from, and of course the immune system deficits. Indeed, people with Cushing disease have almost 5 times higher morbidity and mortality rates compared with the general population. It's a big diagnostic challenge. It's not always easy to find the pituitary tumor. In more than 50% of the cases, it's not obvious on the MRIs. It's a big challenge in treatment because when we don't have an obvious tumor, we don't have a real target to guide the surgical resection. However, we have some recent innovations in the treatment of Cushing disease, and the endoscopic endonasal approach represents one of them, with the ability to give to the surgeon a panoramic visualization of the whole anatomy and allow safe manipulations of the pituitary gland in order to safely remove the pituitary tumor. Stereotactic radiosurgery is also available the last few decades, and it is an advanced method in treatment compared with the traditional radiation therapy. Hypocortisolemia is associated with a significant number of clinical manifestations. It's a result of exposure to the seizure, to the tissues of high cortisol levels, and the most important clinical manifestations for people with Cushing disease is obesity and metabolic alterations. Obesity actually can be present in 82% of the people with Cushing disease. Metabolic alteration, the most important thing besides dyslipidemia and hypercholesterolemia, is diabetes. Almost 40 to 50% of people with Cushing disease have been diagnosed also with diabetes. Hypertension we used to call them a slow killer. 50% of people with Cushing disease will have hypertension. Cardiovascular complications as a result of the hypertension can be devastating. Cushing disease people have almost 4 times a higher rate of acute myocardial infarction compared with the general population. Almost twice as high prevalence of a stroke compared with the general population. Changes with blood clot formation, people with Cushing disease have the condition that we call hyperviscosity syndrome, high rates of thromboembolism. And of course, the neuropsychiatric disorders, usually conditions like depression that in some occasions can be underestimated but have a devastated result in the quality of life of these patients. Patients with Cushing disease have damage of their memory, usually decreased short-term memory, shows irritability, decreased concentration, high levels of anxiety, changes of their behavior, and common emotional disorders. In terms of muscular problems, we have weak muscles, the bones can become very weak, and osteoporosis is a very common characteristic of this condition. And of course, given the deficits in the immune system, we have many opportunistic and bacterial infections. The list of the most common symptoms, the central obesity, usually at the central body, while hips and shoulders remain relatively thin, the moon face, red, rubby face with very often acne, changes with the growth, the hair growth, the fat around the neck, what we also call the buffalo hump, the red stretch marks, characteristic red, in contrast with the whitish stretch marks after pregnancy, for example. And the reason is that the skin is becoming so thin, which is pretty much translucent, and under the skin the vascular structures are more visible, and that's why these stretch marks are red. Of course, all these neuropsychiatric problems that we described, and of course some gonadal dysfunction. In women, 56% of Cushing disease ladies have irregular menstruation. A big percentage have reduced libido, and in men we can see erectile dysfunction. Before discussing about the diagnosis and the treatment, the anatomy is something very important to understand. The pituitary gland is the location, the origin of the pituitary tumors in Cushing disease. The pituitary gland is a very small gland, just 1 centimeter in the maximum diameter, which is located in the center of the skull base, in this bony anatomy that we call cella turcica. The pituitary gland is composed by 2 lobes, the anterior and the posterior gland. The anterior gland is responsible for the majority of the pituitary hormones, and it is connected with the pituitary stalk, with the hypothalamus, which is located just on top of the gland, and it is responsible. It really controls the function of the pituitary gland. Looking at this illustration, it is important to understand the relationship of the pituitary gland with the surrounding anatomy. Just on top of the pituitary gland, we have the optic nerves that formates the optic chiasm. We can see it here in the sagittal and the coronal view. Laterally, we have these areas that we call cavernous sinus. This is an area full of blood, venous blood, and also this is the area where the carotid arteries coming from the neck are getting inside the sinus and then exit to get inside the brain. Also, in the cavernous sinus, we have these yellow structures which are representing the cranial nerves. 3rd, 4th, and 6th are the cranial nerves responsible for the movements of the eyes. So we can imagine that a tumor which originates in this very small anatomical area is going first of all to compress the gland, creating mass effect and potentially hypopituitarism. The tumor can grow superiorly and start extending and compressing the optic chiasm, and this is why people with some big pituitary adenomas presents with visual deterioration. And also, a pituitary adenoma can invade the cavernous sinus, extend in the sinus, surrounds the carotid artery, and in this case it really represents a surgical challenge because of the anatomy and the need to dissect around so vital neurovascular structures. Although very small, we used to call the pituitary gland the master gland of our body, and that's because of the secretion of these vital hormones, growth hormone potential for the children, adrenocorticotrophic hormone, the ACTH, especially the hormone related with Cushing disease, thyroid stimulating hormone, that way the pituitary gland controls the function of the thyroid gland, the prolactin hormone for the mammary glands for the production of the milk, and of course the gonadotrophic hormones which controls the ovaries and the testes. By this means, the pituitary gland is responsible for the endocrine function, the normal endocrine function of our body. So pituitary adenomas are generally separated in two categories, in non-functioning, where the result of the presence is demonstrated with the mass effect in the surrounding anatomy, and the functional pituitary adenomas, and this is where Cushing disease comes. We have adenomas that produce prolactin, growth hormone, ACTH, TSH. Just 15% of all the functional pituitary adenomas results in Cushing disease by hypersecreting ACTH. In terms of size, pituitary adenomas can be very small, micro, smaller than 1 centimeter, macro, more than 10 millimeters, 1 centimeter, like in this case, or giant, more than 4 centimeter. And we can see the mass effect. In this case, we cannot really recognize the normal gland. We can see here the arrowheads, so the optic chiasm elevated and compressed by the tumor, and also the tumor invades the left cavernous sinus. The hypothalamus is a very important structure. It is located just on top of the pituitary gland. It is responsible for the autonomic nervous system and also totally controls the function of the pituitary gland. The way the hypothalamus controls the gland is by the secretion of the hypothalamic releasing or inhibitory hormones. And what is happening is that the hypothalamus is producing these releasing or inhibitory hormones. These hormones are secreted in this hypothalamic hypophyseal portal system. This is a vascular system, and the hormones through the blood circulations are arriving in the anterior part of the gland, giving trigger for the secretion of the anterior pituitary gland hormones. The pituitary hormones then are secreted in the blood circulation through the cavernous sinus, through this venous drainage. All the hormones here that the hypothalamus is secreting, and the most important for the Cushing disease is the CRH, the corticotrophic releasing hormone that stimulates the specific cells of the pituitary gland for production of ACTH. And this is an overview showing how the anterior pituitary gland is under the constant control of the hypothalamus by secreting of these stimulating or inhibitory hormones. The pituitary gland is releasing the hormones that are arriving to the target organs, and then the target glands are secreting the target hormones. This is a very busy slide, but the message behind that is that all these hormones, all this circulation is under a constant balance. It is the autoregulation system of our body. The brain stimulates the hypothalamus, that stimulates the pituitary, which stimulates the target glands for the secretion of peripheral hormones. But at any point, the peripheral hormones or the pituitary hormones can have a negative feedback. That means that in conditions where we have hypercortisolemia, the cortisol is going to try to minimize the secretion of CRH or ACTH from the pituitary gland in order to keep things under control. This is the constant balance in a normal individual. This is what is happening when there is no disease. And of course, there are exogenous factors, steroids or other medications, stress, fasting, all these conditions can change this autoregulation system. Now, what is happening in case of Cushing disease? We have a tumor, a pituitary adenoma, that hyperproducing ACTH, resulting in increased cortisol levels, and then increased cortisol results in lower CRH level. ACTH is not always elevated because the ACTH source, a pituitary adenoma, remains under this constant autoregulation system. However, it has some independency, so CRH cannot always suppress ACTH. ACTH in Cushing disease is going to be either elevated or normal. This is in contrast with the other causes of hypercortisolemia, where ACTH is going to be very low when we have an adrenal tumor. But when we have an ectopic source of production of ACTH, the CRH, this autoregulation system can have no effect at all, because this is usually in the lung, it's not in the axis of the hypothalamic hypopituitary control. Now, the diagnosis of the disease is a real challenge for the endocrinologist. The first step for the diagnosis is to confirm Cushing syndrome, the condition of hypercortisolemia. Once we have the definition of Cushing syndrome, it is important to diagnose between an ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome. And if we know that ACTH hyperproduction is the source, the reason of hypercortisolemia, then we have to determine if the source is the pituitary gland or an ectopic source. The basal tests that we use for the diagnosis of Cushing disease is the blood work. We can also use the salivary cortisol levels. 24 hours urine free cortisol is another very commonly used test. However, there are conditions such as polycystic ovarian syndrome or depression that can also give us a high level of cortisol in urine. The plasma level, the serum level of ACTH. Again, this is not a straightforward diagnosis. Only when ACTH is very low, we can start thinking that we should rule out Cushing disease. In this case, the next diagnostic option is going to be an abdominal CT. The target is going to be, the suspicion is going to be adrenal tumors. However, when we have high or normal ACTH, we have to proceed to a new set of tests, including CRH administration, pituitary MRI, dexamethasone suppression test, and inferior petrol sinus sampling. The CRH is the test when we provide CRH, and it is a good test for to differentiate between Cushing disease and ectopic Cushing and ectopic ACTH secreting syndrome. It is a test that is very good to differentiate between the two conditions, but the cutoffs for interpretation of the test are not standardized. The dexamethasone suppression test, the high dose test, is considered the key diagnostic finding in Cushing disease. What is happening? The dexamethasone in normal individuals suppresses the secretion of CRH, which suppresses ACTH, and as a result, cortisol levels are going to be low. However, in ACTH secreting pituitary adenomas, the set point for ACTH suppressibility by glucosteroids is altered, and as a result, low dose of dexamethasone cannot suppress significantly the cortisol levels. It is only the high dose dexamethasone test, 8 milligrams of dexamethasone, which is going to be positive by suppressing the cortisol. And of course, when we start thinking that the reason of hypercortisolemia is a pituitary adenoma, we have to confirm that with an MRI. And the pituitary MRI nowadays, we're using high technology and many Tesla MRIs that can show us very small tumors. However, more than 40% of the patients with Cushing disease have a negative imaging. And that's because some tumors are very small. 90% of the pituitary adenomas in Cushing disease are very, very small, and it cannot be picked up by the pituitary MRI. We cannot miss this tumor, but in this MRI, we have to be a very high suspicion rate to diagnose this little hypointense area. And of course, this is a case that we can see a tumor. 40% again is going to be totally negative MRI. And once we have this big challenge that we do have clinical and biochemical evidence of Cushing disease but without a pituitary adenoma, the next step, that the next test that we are using is the bilateral inferior petrosal sinus sampling. What is this test? This is an invasive test, an endovascular test, This is the skull base, this is the area of the pituitary, the carotid arteries, the cavernous sinus, where the rates of ACTH are higher when we have an ACTH pituitary adenoma. This is the source, actually, this area, the source of the ACTH. So what we are doing is to catheterize the vein, go through the jugular vein at the origins of the inferior petrosal sinus. This is the inferior petrosal sinus that connects the cavernous sinus with the regular circulation. We are collecting samples of blood from both the two inferior petrosal sinus, and we compare the concentration of ACTH from here and the periphery. We have to have a big ratio, a big difference, if the source of the pituitary of the Cushing disease, of the Cushing syndrome, is a Cushing disease, is a pituitary adenoma, the levels of ACTH are going to be much higher in this area compared with the periphery. However, negative, false negative results can be present. Anatomical changes can be a result of these false negative results. To summarize, we need, for the diagnosis of Cushing disease, we need the clinical suspicion, we need to run the regular test, urine cortisol levels, dexamethasone suppression, MEET9 salivary cortisol levels, in order to have the original suspicion of the disease. ACTH, in case which are normal or high, we need to have an MRI. And if the pituitary adenoma is obvious and the dexamethasone suppression test can confirm the diagnosis, we have the diagnosis and then we need to do the surgery. If, however, pituitary adenoma is not obvious, then the next step is going to be the inferior petrosal sinus sampling with CRH. The history of treatment, after we are able to have the diagnosis during this combination of challenging tests, sometimes it takes a long time of time to have the final diagnosis, we have to proceed with the treatment. The 50s and 60s, the treatment was guided on the target organs, on the adrenal glands, and it was consisted of a bilateral adrenalectomy. Of course, this is not the treatment nowadays, not the first line treatment. Just in 69, the first pituitary surgery for a resection of a pituitary adenoma for the treatment of Cushing disease was reported. The most recent years, we have the microscope introduced in the treatment in neurosurgery, and using the transsphenoidal approach, the transsphenoidal surgery nowadays represents the golden standard for the remission of Cushing disease. The last 15 years, we have seen the endoscopic introduced in skull-based surgery. We are using the endoscope through the nose, and through the same trajectory, the transsphenoidal approach, we are able to reach the area, explore extensively the pituitary gland and the surrounding area, and remove the pituitary tumor. And in my experience, this is the golden standard nowadays, and the results are better compared with the traditional microscopic approach. This is what is happening with the microscope. We have the patient, we introduce the speculum either in the nose or through the sublabial incision. The speculum is reaching all the way through the nasal cavity and it stops just in front of the sphenoid sinus. This is the sphenoid sinus and here is the pituitary gland. Now, the speculum itself is a limitation for surgical manipulation, but even more important, it is a limitation for the light. The light is coming from outside, so the light is brought only in the area of the pituitary. This is an image during surgery. We don't have the option to see beyond the limitations of the speculum, so sometimes we use some angle instrumentation with the microscope in order to make sure that we have reached the supracellular extension of the tumor. And this is the resolutionary approach. This is the endoscope. The endoscope has the light source at the tip and also the camera. at the tip. By introducing the endoscope through the nose, we have the option to visualize all the areas of the skull base and not only the pituitary gland. By that means, we can have access in areas that the microscope cannot reach and it can have a big magnification of the image, resulting in very good surgical outcomes. The skull base from inside, and this is the target area, the pituitary gland is here. We bring the light through the nose, we can have access, excuse me, both to the anterior skull base and to the posterior, to the entire skull base. This is from anatomical dissections in the lab. This is how the pituitary gland looks like, and you can see now the relationship with the carotid arteries, which is bilateral. This view is not possible with the microscope. The microscope view is going to be limited on top of the pituitary gland, but with the endoscope we can see the carotid arteries, and actually this is just for demonstration of the options of the endoscope. We can see the entire skull base. This is the pituitary gland. You see the optic nerves, the optic chiasm, you see the carotid arteries here, this is the posterior skull base, the basilar artery, all the amazing, the impressive anatomy of the skull base available through the nose with the endoscope. This is how the surgery goes with a microscope. The surgeon on top of the patient, the surgical tools through the speculum, the microscope from above. With the endoscopic approach, we're not looking on the patient, we're looking on the monitors, everything in high definition. We have a two surgeons technique. There's always an ENT driving the endoscope while the pituitary neurosurgeon is performing the tumor resection. This is the surgical field with the endoscope. This is how we place the speculum in the patient's nose. And again, the big change, this is the speculum and the light source just on top of the pituitary area, while with the endoscope we can explore the entire skull base. And although this is a real case, this is what we can see with the endoscope: carotid arteries, pituitary area, optic nerves. The limitations of the speculum is going to give us visualization of only these limited areas. So the goals of treatment for a Cushing disease, the goal of surgery is to achieve a gross total resection of the tumor. We need to see absence of tumor in the post-op MRI. Ideally, we need a confirmation with a pathologic report. It's not always easy, not because we can not find the tumor, but even when we can find the tumor, usually pituitary adenomas, ACTH secreting adenomas, are very soft inconsistency. They can be totally removed with the suction that we use during the resection of the tumor, and we cannot have a specimen to send for pathology. It has been shown, however, that gross total resection, remission after gross total resection can reach up to 90%, but without histological confirmation, the rates are usually lower. So with pituitary surgery, the remission of the disease can be very high, can reach in the most recent publications a rate of 98%. The problem is that although this is very promising, we have very often recurrence of the disease, and in long term this recurrence can happen in one third of the patients that had experienced remission of the disease. The reason now of this variation in reported remission and relapse rates is because of the different ways to define the remission, the success of the surgery, and because of the length of follow-up. Usually recurrence of the disease occurs 5 years after surgery. However, it has been cases where the recurrence happened 30 years after surgery. By that saying, every patient with Cushing disease after pituitary surgery have to stay for many years, pretty much forever, under the follow-up of endocrinologists. Given the high recurrence rates, it became very important to identify an early postoperative predictor for sustained remission and disease confirmation. So the best early predictor of successful surgery is the condition of hypocortisolemia at the first few days after surgery. Recent studies have shown that low cortisol levels. We say that the cortisol has to crash within the first days after surgery, and we expect this cortisol level to be below 5 in order to have a good outcome, to target, to expect remission, and long-term, actually, remission. Some studies put the barrier even lower. Some authors suggest that hypocortisolemia should be below 2. This is not confirmed, however. As long as we can achieve within the first few days a low cortisol level of less than 5, we consider that this is the best surgical outcome. Sometimes in cases of persistent disease, this hypocortisolemia cannot be achieved within a few days. It may take several weeks. However, if the cortisol serum levels remain above 5 for 6 weeks after surgery, this is considered a persistent disease, and the patient should be considered for a repeat surgery as soon as possible, or adjuvant radiation or medication-based therapies. This is an overview, a review actually, of recent retrospective studies of Cushing disease, and what it is important to notice in this table, that was a very interesting issue of the Pituitary Journal. You can see that the higher recurrence rates happen in cases where we have a very long follow-up, and this is why long-term endocrinology follow-up is critical, and especially high rates was happened to cases where hypocortisolemia was not achieved. Normal cortisol level was usually the result of the surgery. Now, special challenges for the pituitary surgeon for Cushing disease is the negative pre-op MRI, and this is, of course, a common sense. I mean, there is no clear surgical target to guide the dissection. In these cases, when we don't have a target on the MRI, we need to go ahead and explore the pituitary gland, trying to find the pituitary tumor. Now, if the pituitary adenoma is not found, the surgeon must decide whether to proceed with total or partial hypophysectomy. And hypophysectomy may result in remission of the disease, however, the patient is going to stay under a lifelong necessity of hormone replacement treatment. Another very challenging condition is the case where the tumor is invasive. Remission rates are very low when we have invasive tumors, especially when the tumor extends inside the cavernous sinus. And this is the area where the endoscopic pituitary surgery becomes very important, because we do have the option with the angle endoscope, with the magnified and panoramic view, to explore the cavernous sinus, while with the microscopic approach, this is an absolute limitation. I have some surgical examples that I think they're interesting, showing the endoscopic endonasal approach. This is a patient with a pituitary adenoma. This is the optic chiasm. This is the pituitary gland compressed to the left, and this is the pituitary adenoma. The tumor is invading the cavernous sinus. This is the carotid artery, these black spots, and also the tumor extends inside the sphenoid sinus. That was a very invasive tumor. So we start the approach through the nose. It is a two-hand approach. We see the suction in the one hand here. We have been inside the sphenoid sinus, and we are using the scissors in order to open this membrane. This membrane is the dura. The dura is the normal structure that covers the brain and the pituitary gland. So after we have removed the bone, we are starting cutting the dura in order to expose the tumor and the gland. With careful manipulations, just to remind you that the dimension here is less than 2 centimeters. So the magnification is high, the resolution of the image is high. We are using these micro dissectors, and you can see this is the pituitary adenoma. This is the tumor which projects inside, which is located inside the cella. And you see that during doing these blunt dissections, we were able to find this tissue, which is a totally different consistency, a different color. This yellowish tissue is the normal pituitary gland. This is the ability when we do microdissection with the two instrumentations, the two-hand technique, we can identify the normal anatomy so that we can preserve it. We continue the dissection, we are using the two suction technique. These are very soft tumors, we can take them off by just by the suction without many manipulations. And now we know that the tumor was invading this area, the right cavernous sinus, so we want to expose the carotid artery to do manipulations and achieve total resection. Here, this structure is the carotid artery. This is a view that cannot be achieved with a microscope. The microscopic view should have been limited in this area. So we have exposed the carotid. We see the medial wall of the cavernous sinus has been totally eroded by the tumor. We are lifting up all this, the dura, and we are able to remove the tumor from the cavernous sinus. This is the stimulator. We are able to stimulate the cranial nerves, in this case the sixth cranial nerve, because we consider that being inside the tumor. And once we know that we are not close to the sixth nerve, then we can use this ring curette and try to evacuate the cavernous sinus from the tumor. All this bleeding that you see, it's venous bleeding, it's normal. Again, as we said, the cavernous sinus is a venous cavity, but we are able to control this venous bleeding with hemostatic agents. It is the magnification of the image that gives the impression of extensive blood loss, but the truth is that we don't really lose a lot of blood during pituitary surgery. So, careful, we have explored everything. We are sure that there is no residual tumor. With meticulous warm water irrigation, we are controlling any bleeding. So now we are ready to do the reconstruction. The carotid artery exposed, the normal pituitary gland. What you can see here is a small piece of mucosa from the patient's nose, the middle turbinate, that we harvest, and we use this piece of mucosa is a patient's autograft, and we are placing that on top of the exposed area. We are going to immobilize it with some hemostatic material. This white tissue is hemostatic agents, and that way we're going to keep the mucosa in place. We're going to use some glue in order to keep everything in place. When we don't have CSF leak, spinal leak during the surgery, this technique for reconstruction is adequate. We don't need anything more extensive like a vascularized nasoseptal flap that we use in extensive cases. Immediate post-op MRI, first day after the surgery actually, you can see the pituitary gland and you see the cavity, the tumor bed. This is the area where the tumor was and now it's totally evacuated. The normal gland in the stalk, the patient has an intact pituitary function. This is the interesting case with a small pituitary adenoma inside the cavernous sinus. This is another case with the microscope would have been enough to remove totally this tumor that goes behind the carotid artery. Here we are in the sphenoid sinus. This is the area, the pituitary gland. With this retractable knife, we cut the dura. We open the dura in the middle of the gland. The venous bleeding, again, we can control that easily. We carefully dissect with the microdissector the dura from the normal gland. We don't want to give any injury to the gland. We want to inspect extensively the area, identify the tumor before doing any surgical resections. So in this case, we have removed the bone on top of the carotid. You can see the carotid here. This is the area of the cavernous sinus. By manipulating the carotid artery and by removing the dura, we can see now this area, part of the gland with a different consistency, a whitish structure, which is the pituitary adenoma actually. Now, ideally, when we do pituitary surgery, we want to remove the pituitary adenoma with its capsule. Most of the pituitary adenomas, unless they are very invasive, have a capsule. It's not always easy. especially with invasive pituitary adenomas or big pituitary adenomas, we cannot find the capsule, in which case we have to dissect around inside the gland and create a plane for resection. And you can see here, this is the pituitary gland intact. We just make a cut to start the resection. This is the carotid artery inside the left cavernous sinus, and we remove the tumor which is invading the cavernous sinus. You see the volume of the gland when we leave intact all this tissue. You don't expect to have any deficit following surgery, any pituitary deficit. Again, the reconstruction with the vascular, with the mucosal graft, and here is the post-op images showing the evacuation of the area. And see how nicely now the post-op MRI corresponds to the intra-op image, when you can see the normal gland lateralized, the carotid artery, the dark spot here, and the tumor bed, which is evacuated after the resection of the tumor. This one was my most challenging Cushing patient because originally the MRI was negative. It was considered negative because indeed the pituitary gland is intact. But if you pay close attention, you can see that in the area around the carotid artery, there is a tumor. That was a tumor originating inside the cavernous sinus, going before, behind, and until before the carotid artery. And that was a very big surgical challenge. And I cannot imagine any other way to remove the tumor than with the endoscope. Inside the cella, this is the normal pituitary gland. This is the area of the tumor. Here is the carotid artery. This is the optic nerve at the left side and at the right. Again, we start opening the pituitary cella. We need now to remove all the bone on top of the carotid artery because we know that the tumor is located in this area. This is the hemostatic agent that we use to control the venous bleeding from the cavernous sinus. Very effective material. Now we have started removing the bone. You can see we need actually to mobilize the carotid in this case because the tumor is hidden behind the carotid. So we need to drill this part of the bone, the clival bone, in order to expose the paraclival carotid artery. The course of the carotid artery is very interesting. It's coming from the neck behind the clival, is making a loop, turns anteriorly, and then goes inside the brain. So here is the intact pituitary gland. Here you can see the carotid artery, the optic nerve, the optico-carotid recess. The tumor is located in this area and not in the regular pituitary gland. The regular step, we open the dura first on the pituitary gland to find the gland, to identify normal tissues, normal anatomy. Careful to avoid injuries on the pituitary gland. With the micro scissors, we can extend the opening towards the cavernous sinus. Yellowish is the color of the normal gland, and here you can see the carotid. The medial wall of the cavernous sinus is eroded. With the scissors, we remove all the adhesions between the pituitary and the carotid in order to manipulate and in order to explore all this area. Again, the tumor is located here behind the loop of the carotid. However, we need to make sure that there is no tumor originating from the gland and extending in the cavernous sinus. Now, with this instrument, we remove the dura, which is also covering the carotid artery. If we don't do this important step, we won't be able to manipulate the carotid artery. And it is important to be able to mobilize the carotid artery to get access in this little corner in order to remove the whole tumor and achieve remission of the disease. Most of the tumor has been already removed with the suction, very soft tumor. So for the rest of the tumor, and in order to send some specimen for pathology, we use the ring curette. Here is the tumor. Very soft inconsistency, pathology confirmed the diagnosis of an ACTH pituitary adenoma. How important it is to remove the entire tumor. We need, you see how we lift up, we elevate the carotid artery in order to explore the area, to make sure that nothing is left behind. And what we are doing here, we are cutting the far lateral margins of the pituitary gland in order to send it for pathology, in order to make sure that there is no any disease because of any tumor in the gland which was not obvious on the MRI. This small residual cannot result in pituitary deficiency, and actually pathology confirmed that this tissue was negative. All the tumor was in the cavernous sinus. This is the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. There is no obvious tumor left. The carotid artery, the paraclival, the loop is lifted with the suction. And what you can see actually here behind the, besides the carotid artery, you can see this oblique structure. This is the sixth cranial nerve. We confirm it with the neuromonitoring that it is the sixth nerve and it is intact throughout the surgery. The sixth nerve is responsible for the lateral movements of our eyes. This is the final view. No reconstruction was necessary for this case, just some tissue glue, and you can see the complete resection. This is just the glue and some blood. We can see that this area, which was full of tumor, this is the carotid artery, now there is no tumor there. Now, this tumor was a persisting one. The cortisol levels that was above 100 the day of surgery was actually below 5, which was the goal, the ideal predictor for remission, 3 days after the surgery. The patient is now a year after surgery and she is still in remission of the disease. Now, there is no surgery which is free of complications. However, the endoscopic endonasal approach for small pituitary adenomas have very few complications. Hypopituitarism can happen when we're going for a hypophysectomy. When we are able to remove a pituitary adenoma with the endoscope, we can identify the gland, so the real rate of hypopituitarism is very low. Carotid artery injury is a very low rate, it is less than 0.5%. However, it can happen and that can be a devastating complication resulting in stroke or death. Very irregular though, and it can be considered as a risk, especially when the tumor is invading the cavernous sinus. Some other complications, even more rare, but usually when we have big tumors to remove, to have spinal leak, spinal fluid leaking, that can result in meningitis. We can have intracranial hemorrhoids, nasal hemorrhoids, thromboembolism, or some endocrine complications like diabetes insipidus or inappropriate antidiuretic hormone syndrome. So what is happening after there is no surgical remission, or there is remission of the disease after surgery? Reoperation. This is what is going to be the first treatment options. We need to go explore again the area. We may find some residual tumor. And in this case, the surgeon has to decide if it is the patient's benefit to proceed with hypophysectomy in order to achieve a remission of the disease. Radiosurgery, this is a modern technique in contrast with the tradition, the traditional radiation therapy. With radiosurgery, the rates of complications are much lower and remission can be achieved up to 75% or after failed surgery. Medical therapy is an additional treatment that can be used especially while waiting the results of radiosurgery, because it's going to take several months, up to a year, for radiosurgery to achieve remission. During this time, the patient is still under hypercortisolemia, so medical therapy may be necessary to control the high cortisol levels. And bilateral adrenalectomy remains a treatment option, especially after there's absolute failure in any other approach, and when there is a high, when there is a very high cortisol levels, that has to be treated immediately because of the high morbidity. Risks are adrenal crisis and Nelson syndrome. And again, 26% in that study, most recent studies have shown that after successful pituitary surgery, the remission rate can be up to 36%. So these patients have to stay under the close follow-up of the endocrinologist pretty much forever. In conclusion, Cushing disease is a very big diagnostic challenge. Pituitary surgery is the gold standard for the treatment of Cushing disease. The endoscopic endonasal approach is a recent applied technique that allows for a panoramic visualization, or visualization of the pituitary gland or the paracellar area. It is a recent approach, so we don't have any large surgical series to show in long follow-up the superior results compared with the microscopic pituitary surgery. However, given the extensive the magnification and the panoramic visualization, it is the best approach to preserve the normal pituitary gland, and it is the only technique to resect tumors that extends inside the cavernous sinus or ectopic paracellar pituitary adenomas. Thank you very much, and for the few minutes that have been left, I will be more than happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much. That was excellent. There are a couple of questions. One of the cases you showed was a tumor that was not in the normal pituitary region. It was behind the carotid. How often does that happen? Is it usually in the pituitary area, or is it often outside of the area, not even connected to the pituitary?
No, usually the tumors are originating from the pituitary gland. The case that I'll show you is really extreme. I haven't seen anything similar before. It can happen. It's not an exception. It's not any case report in the literature, but it is very rare to have these cases. Usually, when the tumor is in the cavernous sinus, it's by extension of the tumor from the gland inside the cavernous sinus, like the second video that I show you. The third video is the exception, is the very, very rare cases.
Okay, thank you. The pathology that's done, is that done during the surgery or after?
So I always send pathology during the surgery, frozen, what we call it. The pathology during the surgery cannot confirm the type of the pituitary adenoma. These are special stains that has to be applied in a later stage. So what the pathology can tell us is that we have, if we have resected pituitary adenoma versus normal pituitary gland. This is very important, especially in cases when we cannot really see the pituitary adenoma on the MRI. So yes, the answer is we always send specimen to confirm pituitary resection of pituitary adenoma. Now, later, we're going to have the final result. The pituitary adenoma, the pathologists are going to tell us if this was indeed an ACTH-producing pituitary adenoma, because we should not forget that a very high rate of population, like 20%, we have non-functional pituitary adenomas which has incidental findings. So a non-functional pituitary adenoma can also be present and not the real source of the Cushing syndrome.
Excellent. Okay. Interesting. What do you recommend when the pathology results of the endoscopic surgery of pituitary gland shows corticotroph hyperplasia of the whole gland?
Okay, this is something that it's very interesting, is the findings, the crux, as they call it. The pathology can show that the pituitary is exposed to high level of cortisol. This is actually what the crux findings represent. When we have this evidence, that again is not diagnostic, in the absence of pituitary adenoma, may indicate that there is an ectopic ACTH producing pituitary adenoma. An ectopic ACTH producing tumor.
Okay. This is part comment, part question. Thanks a lot for the nice lecture. How do you explore the ICA intraoperative? Do you use microdoppler or just the navigation?
We always confirm with the navigation. The knowledge of the anatomy, of course, is the most important thing. You have to know where to expect the carotid artery. The carotid artery may not be covered by bone. The bone may be eroded, so we have to be very careful during the dissection. We always use the image guidance, and in challenging cases where the anatomy is totally eroded because of a tumor, we can use the microdoppler. It's not the routine. Usually the image guidance, which is my routine in my surgeries, are enough to show us the exact location of the carotid. But the microdoppler, yes, it's a very good indication in some challenging cases.
Okay, and then surgery versus medicine results.
Surgery is a treatment. Medicine is going to be a way to control the disease. The medicine is not going to offer a real treatment. The real treatment is to remove the tumor which is responsible for the hypercortisolemia. Medication is going to be a very good treatment option in order to keep cortisol levels under control. But remission of the disease cannot be achieved if we stop medication without removing the tumor. So number one is surgery. If surgery fails, then we have to proceed with radiation. Radiosurgery will be the number two option, and medical treatment again can be provided during the time waiting for the results of radiosurgery. However, there have been some recent studies showing that remission of the disease following radiosurgery can be achieved earlier if the patient is not under medical treatment. I don't want to comment on that because I don't prescribe medical treatment. I'm doing just the surgery. I'm not against medical treatment. Definitely people need to be under medication to control the disease, to control the comorbidities and the high morbidity rates because of the disease. But again, no one should consider that medication is the first line of treatment. It is just an additional and adjuvant treatment. The primary treatment is surgery.
Okay. Have you ever encountered carotid injury? And if so, how do you manage?
Not in my hands. I have seen it happening, however. My training in skull base was extensive in many big centers in the world, not only in the United States but also in Europe. I have seen that happening. It is a devastating condition, a very stressful condition during the surgery. This is why I believe that this kind of extended endoscopic approaches have to take place in big academic departments where we have the resources of endovascular treatment, of a good vascular surgeon. So what is going to happen? First of all, we have to control the bleeding. We will try first to control the bleeding with the bipolar, coagulating the wall of the carotid artery. Sometimes can be enough to stop the bleeding. But sometimes this is not enough. I have seen cases where the carotid artery was totally injured by the scissors, in which case we may have to tamponate the area with patties and bring the patient directly to the angio suite in order to do an endovascular evaluation and try for endovascular treatment. We may use standing of the carotid artery. But during this procedure, during compressing the carotid artery in order to achieve hemostasis, the patient remain under very high risk of a stroke. I'm very happy. I'm grateful that it has not happened. It's definitely not a very a common complication, especially not in pituitary adenomas, but it is a complication that can happen in extensive skull-based surgeries, specifically for tumors like meningiomas or chordomas.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. What is the best variant of wound closing in order to avoid liquor leakage?
CSF leak. So if we don't have CSF leak during the surgery, the rate of CSF leak after is very, very limited. So in these cases, like all the three videos that I show you, I didn't have CSF leak during the surgery. In this case, someone can use pretty much nothing, just a tissue glue. Someone can use these little grafts of mucosa that I show you. We harvest them from the middle turbinate, from the nose, and that will be more than enough. There is nothing, no other risk than CSF leak. Now, if we do have leakage during the surgery, then we have to make sure that we have a good closure. We may need to harvest some fat from the patient's belly. A fat graft is the best material to do a watertight closure to seal the area. We use the fat graft in the defect to stop the CSF leak. The best way that we use with the endoscopic endonasal approach is the vascularized nasal septal flap. This is vascularized tissue. We harvest this tissue at the beginning of the surgery. We harvest this tissue from the nasal septum, is the mucosa, but we keep this mucosa attached to the feeders. So we preserve this flap inside the patient's nasopharynx, and at the end of the surgery, we rotate this flap and we cover the entire skull-based defect. This flap is vascularized, the healing is very, very good, is going to stop leakage in the vast majority of the surgeries. And actually, CSF leak was the main criticism for using the endoscopic endonasal approach for extensive skull-based surgeries. And the criticism was that it is associated with very high rates of CSF leak. Well, this is not the case nowadays, and that's because of the revolution of the development of the vascularized nasoseptal flap. Again, however, I would like to make a comment on that. CSF leak for pituitary surgery, especially for small pituitary adenomas, is very, very rare. CSF leak is going to happen in big pituitary adenomas or in other pathologies other than pituitaries.
Okay, thank you. What is the youngest patient you treated that had Cushing's disease?
At the University of Louisville, somehow the adult and the pediatric population hospitals are separated. So I am practicing at the adult. I'm not involved with the pediatric patients. So probably a pediatric pituitary neurosurgeon will be the best person to describe that, to give this answer, but I know from the literature that very young children can suffer from pituitary Cushing disease, and that can be devastating because this shows delayed development and problems with their performance at school. I don't have a number, an age to give you, but it can be even at the preschool years.
Wow, okay. Thank you very much for your presentation. Could you please make a comment for the use of pasireotide Signifor in the therapy of Cushing's disease?
Medication treatment?
Yes.
I will not be, again, the perfect person to comment on that. I'm a neurosurgeon. My goal is to remove the tumor. I trust percent are excellent endocrinologists that we have here in Louisville, and in case that there is no remission of the disease, especially after the second surgery, which is going to be my plan, I trust the endocrinologist for updates and new medications.
Okay, excellent. I think that covers our questions. We've gone a little bit over time, but it was worth it to get those answered. Thank you so much for a very fascinating and valuable information you provided. This concludes today's This concludes today's webinar presentation. We appreciate you taking the time to join us. If we did not get a chance to answer your questions, which I think we did get to all of them, we'll be answering them by email. If you missed any part of this webinar, or if you would like to share it with your family members or friends, it will be available on our website after it is edited. The PNA wishes to thank you for participating in our webinar. There'll be a brief survey after the webinar. Please fill it out to help us provide you with the information you need. Thank you for joining us, and enjoy the rest of your day. And we're getting a lot of messages to you, Dr. Kurushu. Thank yous, and everybody appreciates your involvement, and we do as well. Thank you again, and everybody have a great day.
Have a great day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.